first of all, let me thank the APPEL team of NASA for giving me this opportunity to be here with you. I'm very proud that I'm seeing a few of those NASA veterans who made all these great things. Standing outside, maybe we were looking at it as a wonder happening in the US. Building the manned space programs, international space stations, and the leadership you have taken in this program of human spaceflight and exploration of space. From India, let me salute you for this achievement, and we would like to see you being the leader for much longer time. And I, from the Space Agency of India, I would like to tell you a few introductory slides on what we do in India on the space activity. This is a center. The Indian Space Research Organization is an organization which is spread across the entire country of India with 12,000 people working in technical area with centers spread across most of the southern area of the country. And I am here in a center called Vikram Sarabhai Space Center, which designs the rockets, the liquid propulsion systems, which makes the liquid engines. The launch station is on the eastern side of India. It's called Satish Dhawan Space Center, named after one of our pioneering person. Then the Space Satellite Center, which is here at Bangalore. We have an application center here, which develops the payloads and makes on the applications. A National Remote Sensing Center, which converts the aerial photography for the applications which we will describe. And we have a host of units work on the space physics, the inertial systems, the electro-optics, on master control facility, tracking centers, and I want physical research laboratories, national aeronautic, this is atmospheric research laboratory. We have a northeastern application center, semiconductor laboratory, and the last is the IIST, which is an institute which we started for space education. We find that we have people not coming up to the space activity, so we started an institute. It is just 4 years old, giving undergraduate course on avionics and space, aerospace, and basic science. Now this organization works on very small budget. This is a budget which is for a 5 year period, which is hardly 600 million, which is distributed for different activities. We started our launch vehicle program in the early 70s, developed a few small rockets, but we are here today making PSLVs and GSLVs, which has a capability to launch 1.6 tons to LEO now and 2 tons to GTO. And we are developing a new rocket called GSLV Mark III, which has a 4-ton capability to GTO. And my job presently is to make it. I am the project director of this. The PSLV is currently operational. Yesterday we had a launch, which was very successful, put a remote sensing satellite in orbit, along with two small satellites, one from Singapore and one from Russia. GSLV is, yes, it's progressing, but we had few failures. We have been using the Russian cryogenic stage for its upper. The one which we made, a cryogenic stage, also failed in the last two missions. So we are under analysis of this failure, and probably in another 5-6 months, we will have the next launch. Being a project director, I would like to tell you something on the one which, which we do on making a new rocket. This is the solid booster of this rocket, which we have recently tested. It's one of the third biggest solid booster of the world. And the liquid stage, which is a core liquid stage, is also has been successfully tested. The one which is yet to be tested is the cryogenic stage, which is under development. This is the testing of the, just ready for the test. This is the liquid engine stage under test. And the cryogenic stage we have tested, but we have not been successful in flight. And we are now developing a new cryogenic stage, which is having 200 kilonewton thrust capability. We had a program of human space flight, but today it's still in the discussion mode. The government has not yet approved this program, but we have started certain demonstration work on the re-entry technologies and has been demonstrated successfully during the year 2007, but it's still on in the preliminary stage. Funding from state is not yet confirmed. This is our launch station where we make the PSLVs or GSLV launches. We have two launch pads similar to the one which I had happened to see the vehicle assembly building. We have a tall building where we build the vehicle, move it out, and go to the launch pad and launch. That's very near to the seashore, like the KSC. I had the same feeling when I stood there. I would like to speak now about the cooperation part of India and the NASA. We started with the work on the spacecrafts with the Fodor Aerospace, building our first communication satellites and launching from US. And later we have built our own spacecraft series, both in communication and remote sensing. But the recent achievement in the Chandrayaan mission, where we had an opportunity to work along with many collaborators and putting the space payloads in the Chandrayaan mission. And I can tell you that without the JPL support, this mission would not have been successful. And we are extremely successful in putting the spacecraft at 100 kilometers orbit around the moon and putting a probe descending to the moon and impacting it. And both the payloads from the M3 payload from NASA as well as the MIP had a contribution in discovering the presence of water in the moon. And these were the payloads from USA. These two were the, and moon mineralogy mapper was the most important payload that has contributed. And we have a host of other payloads from ESA. And four more payloads from India. So you can see the Chandrayaan payloads covered the entire the electromagnetic spectrum. This was one of the most important aspect of this payload selection and incorporation. This was just a 1,100 kilogram spacecraft having this capability. And we are now building the Chandrayaan 2, which is planned to be launched in another 2 years. But it is going to be a collaboration with Russia. We will have a rover and a lander in that mission. And probably we may have it. We are in the process of discussing the third mission, maybe. Presently, there is a discussion going on at JPL with our colleagues, who was a principal investigator in the Chandrayaan 1 mission on the Moonrise program. And there is a discussion going on how ISRO and NASA can collaborate on that work. Our role possibly is limited to the putting an orbiter around moon and rest of the experiments part by the NASA. So I want to show you this slide, which is a recent one, where your administrator and the new chairman of ISRO, Mr. Radhakrishnan, signed a protocol or minutes on the possible collaboration between NASA and ISRO. And I happen to be standing there. Okay, so I said about this cooperation. Of course, there are in the last meeting, there is a proposal now to work on the International Space Station, what type of experiments ISRO would like to participate in this the space station activities. And we are working out this in ISRO, basically on the Earth observation and climate study areas, possible payloads can be identified. And also there is the Indian Institute of Space Technology, which is working with the Caltech on some of the educational aspects of space also. We have in India collaboration with many other spacefaring nations. We have discussions in the cooperation with the UK, very long-standing collaboration with SCP and Europe. I want to tell you that one of our liquid engine called the Viking was jointly developed during the early 80s with the ISRO people working along with SCP. And we are still using it, but Ariane 4 now no longer uses it. We have a cooperation with CNES, and two spacecrafts are just scheduled to be launched. One is called Megatropics. It's a joint development between France and India. And also two payloads called Saral and Altica, which are, again, science missions. Russian collaboration also has been there for a very long time. We have procured cryogenic stages, which about 8 of them have been used. We have GLONASS collaboration. We have, on 20th, last day, yesterday, there was a launch of one of the small satellites from Russia. And we also work with the Roscosmos on the human spaceflight studies right now. and also collaboration with the ASEAN countries. Now, to end my slide, I would like to tell a few of the reflections which we have shared them yesterday. Is first about our future programs of ISRO, and also the thrust on social development, which I didn't put here. Basically, the ISRO's approach to the space activities purely for social purposes, and the applications of the remote sensing, we have been using it very largely for the studies related to the use of Earth, the minerals, maybe the water, the planning part. And we also have the communication satellite, large number of spacecrafts where we find acute shortage of the communication transponders, and we are still depending upon the procured launches, and is Ariane Space used to be the prime launch provider for us. Our programs on human spaceflight is still in the study phase. It is yet to take up to a larger scale. And the rocket which we just now discussed is what is planned to be finally human rated, where which we can make those human launches maybe 20 years from now. Now, I also face the similar problems in organization which you are now discussing here, the Passing the Torch 3 program, where we have the interaction between the veterans and the new generation. Our organization is about 45 years old now. So we also see this problem of many large number of people retiring and the new faces coming up in our organization. And the few of the problems which we see are the information or the knowledge is still residing in the brain and nothing is being put on paper. The next generation who wants to work on it finds it extremely difficult on how they went through and generated all those procedures, protocols, or the mechanisms. The one thing which I see very clearly is about the review processes. The reviewers are not now vanishing. We are not able to even to find a good reviewer for a system. So we still keep our veterans at bay so that they can always come and help us in designing or reviewing any new systems. So this capability development is one important aspect of any organization of this type, which have the knowledge mostly in the minds and not easy to put it on paper, which is why call it knowledge. Knowledge it can all can only information can be on paper. It is an accumulated experience of the person that has to be there. So this is one issue. And second issue is availability of good trained manpower. In an organization like us, when you have going through this transition of the organization from a government organization basically being ours, which not pay handsomely like any like an industry or an IT profession which provides you. So this challenge of getting the right people for the job is also a big problem which we are facing. And the technology problems, of course, is a big problem for ISRO. Basically having no aerospace industry in the country virtually. So it has to be all done by ISRO, right from the pyrotechnics to the avionics to the structures to the fabrication, propellants. Everything has to be done by this single umbrella center. The entire design has to be done. There is nobody to look for here by Boeing or McDonnell Douglas to you can discuss. Nobody there. So this is a core group of technical people who have to do the entire development. So this is, again, a big challenge as an organization. So I would like thank you for giving this opportunity to reflect on us. And I was all the time learning about how you went through and developed your programs and the vision for future. And I'm sure, given an opportunity, I would like, at the end of this, I would like to offer my comments on it and how I took the whole program. Thank you.